Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Colorado. We're going to get started in just about 10 or 15 minutes, so if you'd like to grab that last cup of coffee, use the facilities that are just out to the right and down the hall, or grab some breakfast, please do so. Thanks so much. Thank you. Good morning again. Please take your seats. My name is Misty Ruthven with the Colorado Department of Education, and it is my distinct pleasure to welcome you to Colorful Colorado. I know that many of you, yes. That many of you had quite a journey to get here, and we very much appreciate you coming. A few housekeeping items before we get started. Please note that you are at altitude. You may live at an altitude that is a bit lower than what we have here in Colorado. So please note you've been given a water bottle and that there are several hydration stations around here. So please utilize that water bottle over the next few days. Additionally, we have had some changes to the wireless code, so please note that that will be on the slides up here and that the one in your program is incorrect. We're also happy to provide you that information at the front. Thank you to our volunteers. We've had so many folks from across the country volunteer to put this together, and we very much appreciate all your help. At this time, I'd like to hand it over to Eric Waldo from the Executive Director of Retire and the First Lady's of the Office. Thank you, Eric.
Good morning. Let's try it one more time. Good morning. All right, that's a Colorado good morning. I needed that. Well, listen, again, I'm just so grateful to be here today. We have 32 state teams from around the country who have committed to this work. As all of you have heard me say before, many of you are friends and are saying hello. You understand the First Lady's work here. And for those of you who may be coming for your first time, I'm just going to give a quick overview before I turn it over to a few other folks. And I'm here as the Executive Director of the First Lady's Reach Higher Initiative. And the First Lady's Reach Higher Initiative is part of the administration's effort to pursue and complete to make sure young people around this country know that a post-secondary education is a prerequisite for success. So we're encouraging young people around the country to pursue and complete their education past high school, whether at a two-year degree, a four-year degree, a community college, an industry-recognized certificate or credential. But some education past high school has to be the goal for every young person around this country to be successful. And we know this and we believe this, and this is why the First Lady and the President have taken on this work and why the First Lady herself has put an emphasis. Now, folks know that I tell people when you talk about Reach Higher, you can think of the First Lady as the school counselor in chief for the country. That deserves applause. I'll take it. And that's why you're all here today. And there are a few just areas of emphasis we're talking about around the counselor experience. And our three key themes for the next 3 days are, number one, professional school counselors are imperative to the success of preparing students for life beyond high school. Counselors are often the first supportive adult where students learn about the world of work. And number two, college is a pathway to a career, and students must be college and career ready. And lastly, partnerships, corporate partnerships, philanthropic partnerships, partnerships between business and education with business-led conversations are essential to helping students have work-ready skills. So this is why we're focused on it. We understand that school counselors are often the difference maker in a young person's life to help them get on that path to a college and a career. With that, let's turn it over to the First Lady herself so you can hear from her in her own words.
Love for being there and being there with the students and getting those frequent visits back when they unbelievable. You're the one person that ties together all the areas of their life, help them make the connections to go out into the world and realize that they have a potential to do anything that they want.
To see people in high positions that actually, you know, care about the work of counselors, because for many years I think it was kind of overshadowed. So now to have the White House staff, to have the First Lady to actually support us and encourage us to have these national awards is just amazing. It encourages us to do the things that we do on a normal basis.
Our 2016 Counselor of the Year, a woman who inspires us all, from young people in her community to aspiring counselors across the country, Catherine Pastor.
Ms. Obama, we are forever indebted to you for the work that you have done for our profession, really we are, and for shining a light on the importance. And for shining that light on the important work that we do for our nation's children. You have been an amazing advocate for us across our country, so thank you.
So that was a highlight from this past year's Counselor of the Year ceremony. And folks who already have heard this, but I want to make sure people hear it well. The First Lady committed at that event that it may be the last event she does as First Lady at the White House, but we are going to host the 2017 Counselor of the Year ceremony at the White House. So be on the lookout. So again, we're so grateful to the University of Colorado, Colorado Springs, for making this campus available to us today. UCCS is known for its connection to industry and for its highly regarded school counselor training program, both of which are topics at this conference. And we know that UCCS can trace its lineage to the great industrialist David Packard, the P in HP. And he understood that we need to plant Colorado Springs as building a plant in Colorado Springs to provide a location and a connection between business and higher ed. And so it should be no surprise that UCCS, with its connection between education and business, is a great place for us to talk about that with respect to school counseling. I'm so pleased today to welcome on the stage to introduce its chancellor, this campus CEO, Dr. Pam Shockley-Zalabak. Dr. Shockley-Zalabak is the author of 9 books and more than 100 articles and productions focusing on organizational communication. But even more impressive is that Dr. Shockley-Zalabak continues to be active in scholarly research, and she still teaches a class to this day. So every semester, students can find her in a classroom doing what she loves to do. And I know that everyone in this room understands the importance of having someone in education who understands what's happening at the ground level, at the student level. So thank you to the University of Colorado for their commitment to the Reach Higher Initiative, and it's my pleasure to introduce Dr. Pam Shockley-Zalabak.
Thank you, Eric, and it's my great pleasure to welcome all of you to the University of Colorado, Colorado Springs, to Colorado Springs, and to Colorado. I specifically today, as we begin our conference, want to thank our Dean of Education, Valerie Martin Conley. She's down over here. The chair of our Counseling and Human Services Department, Joe Ehrman. Joe is over here. And Associate Professor Rhonda Williams. Rhonda is right over there, for not only making this conference possible, but really creating a school counselor program that is truly excellent. Now, in welcoming you, I'm really reminded of the importance of what you do. But I'm reminded more than you might think. Last night, I had 25 kids from the Denver metro area at my home for dinner. These are low income, they all would be first generation if we get them to go on, kids whose counselors, not their families, have identified them as having enormous potential, but no direction to go for additional training, a community college, or a 4-year degree. We run this program based on philanthropic contributions every summer, and I have them for dinner every summer. And we talk about why they need to go beyond high school. And we start with why they need to finish high school. But last night, we talked about what kind of messages they're getting. We have kind of a campfire. My house didn't have a campfire in it, but we have kind of a campfire discussion about what are the messages you're getting? Do you think it's possible? What are the barriers? Let's talk about money. Let's talk about where, what, and how you identify. And one of the profound things that I heard was the only person in at least 60% of the lives in that room who were saying, go on, was a counselor. And I'm serious. I didn't make that up. I knew I was doing this today. I didn't even know that was scheduled. I do that every summer, so I knew it was scheduled. But I didn't know it was last night. But it really brought home to me the powerful impact that you have on lives. And sometimes you're the only line of defense for what that future looks like. And I clearly know that. These kids are wonderful. I invited them all today. You know, they're on campus actually taking a course today. You actually should interact with all of them. But the reality is, over 20 years ago, we formed for this campus a high school counselor advisory group. It meets, and it's about 40 counselors throughout the southern part of the state, meets twice a year to tell us how we can better bridge the gaps between high school and even middle school, and what we are doing at the university, and then how that translates into what we need to do with business and industry. So I'm so delighted to have you from so many different states and different perspectives collectively working on how do we deal with bridging the gaps that exist in our country between where people are with potential and what is possible and how we go forward. I read recently that only 36% of the public and one-third of business leaders believe that our college graduates are prepared for workplace success. That's not good enough. And we need to talk together, counselors at all levels, community colleges, training centers, four-year institutions and beyond, on how we can work more collaboratively with our individual roles and then our collective roles. Margaret Mead, and I think probably everyone in the room has heard this quote, but it's important, has told us, never doubt that a small group of thoughtful, committed people can change the world. Indeed, it is the only thing that ever has. And you are a small group, but a powerful group and an influential group. You may have noticed that we welcomed you with banners on the campus saying, reach higher. Actually, that has been our social media slogan for a number of years. So we are, in fact, combined with the White House initiative on how we can, I didn't say a thing about copyright, Eric, but the reality, we have combined with the White House initiative on really believing that Reach Higher is a wonderful theme for all of us. And so today, I would say it's not just for the students that we're focusing on. It's not just for business and industry. It's for faculty, staff, and students. How do we all reach higher? So it's really my pleasure for us to be hosting this important conference. And now, welcome again to UCCS, and I'm going to turn it back over to Eric.
So now, you know, I get to play two roles. I'm both master of ceremonies, and I'm going to say a few words right now about our work. And again, just so grateful to the University of Colorado, Colorado Springs, for being here and letting us host this ceremony together. What I think is really important is for folks who know me know that whenever I start a convening, whether it's a meeting of my team internally or whether it's meeting with students like I did yesterday with students from Gear Up or coming to a large convening like this, I like to tell folks about how much time I think we have left in office. And today we have 219 days left in the Obama administration. And that is something that I say not just to say, you know, where am I going to be? Where's my vacation during 19 days? It's really because the president and the first lady are so focused on using every single one of those days to make sure that more students, more counselors, more young people, more people who have not had opportunity can have more of it. And so we are committed to running through the tape, using every single one of those days to make sure that we're making a difference. And that's why I'm so appreciative of each and every one of you who are here today. It is incredible that we have 32 state teams here. Can I get a show of hands, how many folks went to another Reach Higher Counseling convening? Look around. You have all been committed to this work, and you didn't say that it was okay just to do one event. You said we need to keep going. And I'm so pleased that this is the fourth counseling convening that we've held, and we are not done yet. We are going to be holding more in the fall, and we are committed to this work, not just for the next 219 days, but really for time immemorial. We are going to keep doing this work because we know that more and more students are going to need our help. Now, let's talk a little bit about the why and the how. Now, folks may have followed recently the Department of Education's Office for Civil Rights issued a report, and it stated that actually, right as of today, over 850,000 high school students had access to no counselor whatsoever. When I usually get up, I talk about the one for every 471 ratio. I'll usually shame the Californians and say it's one counselor for every 1,000 students. But it's important for us to recognize that there are some students who don't have access to any counselors whatsoever. So our work is not done. And I will tell you and all of you that I think that the work that the First Lady has tried to engender is something that we can use our national platform on, but we can't be successful if each and every one of you isn't committed to going back to your communities, to making those partnerships with business leaders, to making those partnerships with your institutes of higher education, so that we're truly thinking about pre-service training, in-service training, thinking about the connections between counselors and students, thinking about how technology can be leveraged to better connect to students where they are. For the folks who are doing the ground-level training for counselors, we know that today's students, these Generation Z, these 14 to 19-year-olds, are communicating on digital platforms that maybe many of us are uncomfortable on. But if we aren't meeting them where they are, these digital natives, we are missing an opportunity for how we can inspire them. So people can laugh about, oh, I don't know how to send a Snapchat, or Instagram is really scary. We actually know today that that's where students are communicating with each other. And one of the initiatives that the First Lady has pushed forward is her Better Make Room campaign, which is part of Reach Higher, but it's really the student-facing portion. So I encourage each and every one of you to check out bettermakeroom.org. You're going to hear from Don Yu at this conference in a few days, and he'll tell you a little bit more about it. But we want to train and change that selfie culture and make it to celebrate education educators. This past year, we celebrated over 1,200 college signing days around the country, and many of you took part in those. And the reason that matters is because those college signing days, taking the theme from a sports signing day where we recognize athletes, said, no, we should be recognizing college going the same way we celebrate celebrity and sports. And the First Lady, you've seen the way she uses her platform to engender people to talk about healthy eating and healthy living. She doesn't do it with grants that she gives out because she doesn't have any. She doesn't do it with regulations because she doesn't regulate. She does it with the power of her voice and the power of her convening authority and the power for people to stand up next to her and say, I want to be like that. I want to do that. And all of you know that the reason this is so personal to the First Lady is because it is her story as well. She herself is a first-generation college graduate. She and her brother Craig were their first in their family to go to college. So when the First Lady talks to young people about the importance of getting onto a college campus, about the importance of filling out the FAFSA and the financial aid, about the importance of taking early college or AP classes or getting that college level readiness before you set foot on campus, it's because she experienced all of those struggles herself. She knew what it was like to go onto a college campus and suddenly feel out of place, to get onto a college campus and suddenly feel academically unprepared. And this is why we all need to commit ourselves to make sure that all students are getting those same opportunities. All students should believe themselves as college material, and all students should then, when they get there, have the tools to be successful. Because what we're going to be talking about today and for the next few days around the connection to partnerships and business, the critical thing to understand is our goal isn't just to get the students to a post-secondary institution, it's to make sure that they are completing, and that they're completing ready with job-ready skills so that employers are saying, this is the type of student, this is the type of graduate I want in our communities, that we want working at our jobs. So I'm overjoyed that all of you are here today. I feel lucky. I sit with the First Lady. We actually just went for our final college graduation commencement at City College of New York about 2 weeks ago. And that graduation was a great testimony to the work we're doing here. You heard from so many students who got up on a stage and talked about an adult who believed in them, an adult who was invested in them and saw their potential. And that is ultimately what school counselors do and see. They are the ones who understand the possibility of a young person. And therefore, they put and invest themselves into that person to make sure that they can have the opportunities that will help them flourish. So you all understand the statistics. I don't need to repeat them all to you, but we need to change the status quo if we are going to make a difference. And that is why each and every one of you is doing something incredible today. And at each one of these convenings that you've come to, you've essentially said, the status quo is not servicing my students. The status quo will not do. We need to have counselors at leadership positions so that they are creating more opportunities, creating a pipeline that isn't just one heroic counselor at a time, but is really a sustained group of professional counselors at the table, at leadership positions, with K-12, with higher ed, with the business community, with nonprofits, to make sure that each and every one of our students has that dream developed, decided, and met. With that, I just want to say a few more things, and then I'm going to turn it over. We have a video from our Secretary of Education, John King. And that is, you know, I want to be clear that our office at the White House wants to do as much as possible while we still occupy the White House to help each and every one of you. Many of you know me, have reached out to me. I've spoken at many of your events, and sometimes I can't go. I apologize. I try to send videos. But I do want to say that if my team can in any way help you further your work, if we can lift up a story of success where you are, we want to do that. We want to bring you to the White House to tell your story, to tell your students' stories, and to hopefully make sure that every single person understands when we step out of office in January of 2017 that how we made a difference on school counseling is a legacy that we can all be proud of. And I can't do it by myself from Washington, D.C. The First Lady can't do it by herself. But we can do it with all of you, which is why I am so hopeful and inspired by each and every one of you. With that, let's turn it over to John King, the U.S. Secretary of Education.
Hi, I'm John King, U.S. Secretary of Education. As many of you know, school counselors are special to me. My mother was a school counselor who I know positively impacted many lives by helping students to meet their potential regardless of the obstacles they faced. I was honored to join the First Lady and the Ask Us School Counselors of the Year this past January at the White House, and I appreciate every opportunity to celebrate counselors' hard work. I'd like to thank Governor Hickenlooper and the Colorado Planning Team for their tireless efforts and dedication, not only to this event, but to students across the state. I'd also like to recognize the National Consortium for School Counseling and Post-Secondary Success for laying the groundwork for these national and regional convenings. Preparing students for success by equipping them with college and career-ready skills is imperative to our mission at the Department of Education. All of our students need a rigorous, well-rounded, and relevant education to thrive in our 21st century global workforce. Whether they make their living in a biotech research lab, repair shop, art studio, digital lab, or at the front of their own classroom, teaching another generation of learners. We owe our students opportunities to try new things and pique their curiosities so they can be prepared not only for the jobs of tomorrow, but so they can discover their passions and live out their dreams. Our job is to open the door and raise the bar, because in the end, our work as educators, counselors, administrators, and families isn't just about getting our students prepared for college. Our work is about getting them prepared for life and all that comes with it. As you know, this takes an immense amount of work on your part, and I appreciate all you do to support each student and often their families with their academic and emotional needs. Thank you for being there to guide students as they plan their educational and life goals. And thank you for helping them through moments of crisis, when it is often students' relationships with their counselors that offer some of the biggest support. I appreciate all you do, and I look forward to learning more about the outcomes of your work over the next 3 days as you exchange ideas across sectors to benefit our students. Thank you, and enjoy this opportunity for collaboration and learning from each other.
It is now my pleasure to introduce Colorado's Governor John Hickenlooper. Governor, thank you for so much for hosting us in your great state of Colorado. John Hickenlooper is a former geologist and entrepreneur who recently added author to his resume with the publication of his memoir, The Opposite of Woe, My Life in Beer and Politics. I gotta get a copy of that. Since taking office in 2011, the governor and his team have endeavored to make Colorado the most pro-business state with the highest environmental and ethical standards. He is also a high-quality investor in terms of education and understands the importance of school counselors and the work we are doing. Please join me in welcoming Governor John Hickenlooper.
Thank you, Eric. Thanks for convening this august group here. I always want to, I'm on this stage, which I've been a few times, give a loud shout out to Dr. Shockley Zalabak, who has been, you know, the two most important initiatives I've been working on for the last couple years. One has been on cybersecurity, and the university under Pam's leadership has been a strong and integral partner on that. And then the other is on workforce and looking at the skills and the training and the preparation for kids, not only to go to college, a community college, whatever education they seek, but to be prepared of how they go about that. And I'm not sure I know too many people in higher education that approach their universe in such a, you know, she's able to look, see the whole field, and yet at the same time go down in the weeds and very focused on individual issues where it's appropriate. I also want to recognize all the panelists. I'll mention Noel Ginsberg in a little while. He's one of our own and has done some remarkable work, which I'll just kind of gloss over because I know he'll be able to talk about it in more detail. I also want to thank all of you for all the tremendous work you do in your home states and recognize that that this is an effort that's not one meeting or one class or, you know, one year, but it really is a lifetime of work for many, many people. Colorado is doing great. You know, our economy is booming. I think we're third or fourth in terms of unemployment. Our unemployment is about right around 3%. We're ranked as one of the best places to start a career, best place for workforce. But at the same time, we, like every other part of the country, have a lot of challenges in terms of the number of people that have either lost their careers or have, you know, technology in some way has altered their career in such a way that if they still have their job, they haven't had a raise in 10 years. And we look at that in parallel with the number of kids that are coming out of high school or dropping out of college or their post-high school education and find themselves in a similar rut with a similar, rather arid array of choices available to them. And we're going through right now one of the largest periods of disruption, certainly in terms of technology innovation, and then the correlative just business innovations that take place when you have changes in technology. But this is akin to when we electrified factories back in the 1920s and the 1930s. And that, of course, the electrification of factories allowed them to come in from, they used to be out by the old mill stream, so there would be power. And then when electrification took place, they came into the cities, but you also had the other innovations like the assembly line and much, much more of greater efficiencies in what one person could create. And the 1920s and the 1930s were, just as they are right now, very disruptive. Anarchists, all kinds of social upheaval, real challenges in terms of employment and being able to transition to these new kinds of jobs that are being created. You know, in Colorado, 88% of what we call top job openings, those are, you know, livable wage jobs, require post-secondary education or training, healthcare, IT, construction, cybersecurity. You know, in 4 years, 70% of all jobs are going to require post-secondary training or education. Now, Colorado does have a heavy focus on education. 68% of our adult population has some level of college experience or earned credentials. 46% have an associate degree or higher. A national average is 38%. I think we're either second or third in the country in that. But to a large extent, a lot of that talent has been imported. You look at also the challenges around minority students attaining degrees and credentials, roughly speaking, at about half the rate of white students. We've, within our Department of Higher Education, been working hard to really focus on the number of first-time, first-generation to complete secondary education in some way, post-secondary education. So the number of Latinos, African-Americans, rural populations has been a big focus. The state developed the Colorado School Counselor Program and added over 200 licensed school counselors in schools and districts across the state. And we did, of course, see a significant increase in the graduation rate at 233 secondary schools in 75 districts, and allowed us to see better success as those kids entered school. But we're still focusing on how to systematize that, how to get maximum benefit for the time that those counselors spend. When I was mayor of Denver, I'm one of those strange people that I never ran for student council or anything. I kind of got goaded into running for mayor of Denver in 2003 because I'd been in the restaurant business for 15 years and kind of shocked everybody that I would win. And with a local philanthropist, we created something right in that the second year I was in office called the Denver Scholarship Foundation. This was an oil and gas, very successful young guy named Tim Marquez. And he made a $50 million commitment. So that we told kids throughout Denver Public Schools is about, now it's almost up to 90,000 students. Back then it was less than 70,000. But we told them if they worked hard enough, money wouldn't be the thing that kept them from going to or completing college. But we realized within 2 years that without more counselors, we were wasting our time. And one of the most powerful things we recognized was how many of the kids that were going to college or considering it didn't even understand what Pell Grants were and didn't know the basic opportunities that they had available to them to encourage them. And I think that challenge really formed a lot of my framework of how I look at this issue. We've pushed the last few years, our state legislature has pushed very hard for concurrent enrollment programs, so kids while they're still in high school can be going to a community college and taking classes and not having to pay for them. Allows classroom learning and real world experience outside of their high schools. Obviously reduces time and cost in terms of attaining post-secondary credentials or degrees afterwards. These concurrent enrollment programs are now offering 80% of the high schools in Colorado. Before 2009, there were roughly a little less than 5,000 students. Now we have about 31,000 students. Hispanic student enrollment grew by 2,700%. I love throwing that number out there. African-American enrollment grew by 4,300%. By any measure, these have been very successful programs of expanding that conduit by which kids can have a more realistic vision of their own success in secondary, post-secondary education. The program Noel Ginsberg's worked on, which I will let him tell in more detail, but really is focusing on apprenticeships based on the Swiss-German model, probably more, I'd say fair to say, a little bit more of the Swiss model. Noel has single-handedly over the last 3 years, Noel has his own business, you'll hear this. He's got allegedly a full-time job. I'm not sure how much time he really spends on that job anymore, but certainly for the last couple of years, he's been spending about 40 hours or 50 hours a week looking at how do we scale an apprenticeship model so that kids can, you know, when they're for their junior or senior year, they can choose to go 3 days a week and work at a business. We're looking at a number of different industries by which this would take place. And then 2 days a week, they work 3 days, and then 2 days they would go either back to their own high school or to a community college, but take classes, but these classes would be calibrated towards the industry in which they're working. Now, I'm not saying that the industry controls that curriculum, but they're gonna have a strong voice in it so that these kids are learning things that will be at a real value. And back when we looked at the effect of our counselors in the Denver Scholarship Foundation, we called them future centers. And we actually went out and tried to find kids who are most like the students we were trying to attract. We're trying to find kids who had just graduated from college to go back into these future centers. And one of the things that we we saw was in many cases, low-income students especially, their time is critical, and they really want to focus on learning things that are going to be directly beneficial to their potential career. This Bell Commission, there's a business education collaboration, really is a remarkable thing. And I'll shut up, and I don't want to take all of Noel's talking points. But I think it's something we're going to be able to scale across the entire state much more rapidly than I think anyone else is really thinking about. Also, we launched in March. We worked with the Markle Foundation in New York. A woman named Zoe Baird, remarkably talented woman, who runs the Markle Foundation. Skillful, and Skillful is in partnership with LinkedIn, and it's a middle skills online platform. It does several things, allows us to go, and right now it's skillful.com is in its most rudimentary form, but eventually you'll be able to go to any class at a university or a community college or many private companies if they're willing to participate. Say Walmart might have a class on how to do inventory, but kids will be able to go onto this website, click on the class, and see what books are included in the curriculum, what they're going to read, but also, you know, not just what they learn, but what skills they will attain proficiency in, and then what types of jobs those skills might be best useful for, and then you can click on those types of jobs and actually be able to see who's hiring and how much money they're paying, where they are. And that leads to the, just last week, in partnership with the U.S. Chamber of Commerce, we're also for Skillful, we're the prototype state. I think we're the only state in the country that's working on it right now. The same thing with the U.S. Chamber of Commerce, although I think they'll roll out even more rapidly. We began the Launch My Career program, which again allows all the work that you're doing and is a tool that hopefully many of you will be able to use sooner than later in states all across the country. But they've gone out and have really measured each different major in the different universities and looked at the cost of attaining that degree and allows kids to look at the types of jobs that you will be prepared for. And again, there's a lot. We understand that students are all different. And some students will take one education curriculum and transform it into a different career. But basically, if you're taking one pattern of coursework to go after a specific career, exactly how much it costs, and depending on where you live, and this so anywhere within the state of Colorado, what the cost of living is, how much debt you'll be able to support, so kids won't be going out and taking large amounts of debt to attain careers where they're really not going to have a viable way of paying back that debt. So this part of the program is called ROI, Return on Investment, and allow counselors or parents or even individual students to be able to look at, how can they actually get real information that inform their decisions. We've had great buy-in from our business community and all of our schools, our training programs, our workforce training programs. This last legislative session, we established a grant program to help nonprofits implement worksite training programs and apprenticeships. And I think we recognize that by training our kids today, if we can get these systems up and really efficiently operating, we have the opportunity to scale them and begin to look at those people in their 40s and their 50s who've lost their careers or haven't had a raise in 10 years to allow them to see in real time what kinds of jobs are available, how much those jobs pay on the average. One of the nice things about this Launch My Career program is it really does show you in your first 5 years in a different career what the average wages are in your community. But then also looks at the last, you know, I think it's the average of the last 10 years in your career, how much you'll make. So you get a more realistic vision of which jobs lead to which kinds of, what level of resources you'll have available for them. And I think if we scale this up to people in their 40s and their 50s, they are going to be able to look at when they leave and transition from one career into another, they're going to have a much more realistic assessment of the opportunities available to them. In this very disruptive time where so many people have lost entire careers, allowing them that choice is a real gift. And I think more often, once we get some of these tools at scale, we're going to find that there are more choices available for people than we think. And one example I use, obviously we have many fewer bank tellers than we used to have. By some measures, roughly 60% less bank tellers than we had 10 or 15 years ago. The skills that a bank teller needs, basically they have to be numerate, they have to have a high sense of precision, they have to have a sense of urgency, they have to be able to work well with others. Well, we've been working very hard on cybersecurity. And not everyone who works in cybersecurity needs a master's degree in electrical engineering or coding. There are many jobs that need 6 months or 9 months, but what kind of skills are required, what kind of proficiencies are required, competencies are required for that person who wants to go into one of the more entry levels jobs of cybersecurity, which, by the way, pay started at about $55,000 a year. Well, they have to be numerate, they have to have a high sense of precision, they have to have a sense of urgency, and more, they have to be able to work well because almost all of these tasks are done in collaborative teams. And that's just one example of a place where, as we're losing jobs in one place, we'll be able to take some of these tools and platforms that we're creating actually for high school kids, but I think they're going to help us work and address some of the issues that we're facing throughout the whole range of people's careers, and that notion, and really establish that notion that it's a lifetime of education is going to create a fully rewarding lifetime of employment. So you guys are all part of this. Obviously on the ground floor, the fact that you're here demonstrates your real initiative. So as the governor of the state of Colorado, I hereby deputize each of you to go back to your states and get on with it. Thank you.
Thank you again, Governor Hickenlooper, for your commitment to education and helping students meet their higher education goals. We really appreciate your passion and your excellence that you bring to the work. Now, with that great example of leadership, it's great to transition now to our next speaker, Jeremy Anderson, who is the president of the Education Commission of the States. And he is just another example of exemplary leadership in higher education. ECS has helped to lead the national conversation around education. Jeremy will outline the national landscape and trends to paint the big picture of what's happening across the United States. Understanding that landscape is key to knowing how we can begin to change that picture. Jeremy is, as I mentioned, the president of the Education Commission of the States. ECS was created by states for states in 1965 to track policy, translate research, provide unbiased advice, and create opportunities for state education policymakers to learn from each other. Jeremy has a strong public service record working with officials in Washington, D.C., with many governors and legislators in states, and with education policy organizations around the country. I now give you Jeremy Anderson.
So it's great to be here and to have everyone here in Colorado. At the Education Commission of the States, we're actually based here in Colorado. And the great thing is, I never get to speak in Colorado. So I'm so excited to have you coming here. We actually have a staff of 40 in Denver. And what we do is we research policies from across the country on education. My staff actually gets excited when a legislature passes an omnibus appropriations bill because they read it from cover to cover. Because what they do is pull out every single education policy that's in there. We put it in a database. And we put it there because we get calls from people like you every single day saying, I want to know how to do dual enrollment better. I want to know who's doing career pathways the best. And we check that database and all of the speeches and testimonies we're doing across the country to help you be better informed. So really what we try to do with the Education Commission of the States is to provide the essential, indispensable services that ed policy leaders need to make a difference. And I say this respectfully because most of the people in states who are working around this arena, they are really, really serious about making a difference, but they don't always have access to all the information on what policies are working. I use as an example one state which the chair of the House Education Committee and the chair of the Senate Education Committee, very, very committed to education policy. One's a farmer, one's a mortician. One's starting life, one's at the end of life, but their education knowledge may not be as much as what they really want to achieve. And that's really what we do with the Education Commission of the States and why I'm excited to be here with you to talk about some of the key issues around the Reach Higher initiative. When we look at what's going to happen best in education policy, we really believe that the best way to move policy is to help inform education policy leaders. I'm in a lot of states where governors and legislators and chief state school officers are saying, you know, what should we be doing for Texas? And my answer is, that's your job. You took that job to make the choice. What I can give you is information on what six or seven other states are doing that's working, or just as important, what's not working. I've been in this job for 4 years now, and I actually started because Governor Hickenlooper hired me when he was chair of the Education Commission of the States. We rotate back and forth between Democratic and Republican governors, and really the services that we provide come into four kind of categories. We do research, like I said, for people who call us all the time from the states on what is the best policy, how do I grow, and what I want our state to do. We do major reports, and I'm going to talk about 8 reports that we have that are all along key Reach Higher initiatives that you're going to be discussing. We do major convenings. Our biggest convening is our National Forum on Education Policy, which is taking place in 2 weeks in DC. And we'll have 60% of the chief state school officers there. And we'll have over half the chairs of education committees there and many governor's offices there because they want to learn from each other. We don't have partisan discussions. For some crazy reason, it just doesn't happen even when we're in DC. But we have people from different parties and different kinds of states learning from each other. We also do a lot of counsel. From me facilitating state board retreats, to testimony we do in the legislature, to commissions that we actually work with, and I'm going to talk about a few committees that we're running in some of your states right now around Reach Higher initiatives. Really, the goal of Reach Higher is to ensure that every student has access to the important tools and the people to support their academic planning. And I don't think there's a time in our country when this has been more important. I use this the slide a lot when I'm across the country giving speeches, but these are employment trends by education level over the last 40 to 50 years. And when you look at what the employment trends were, what was the education level people needed in 1964 versus today, it is a dramatic change. And so the work that is happening right now with Reach Higher and why the First Lady is working to rally the country around the President's North Star goal is extremely important for everything we're doing. Whether you're a state education leader, whether you're a school superintendent, a principal, a teacher, a school counselor, or a parent. So what I want to do is talk about some of the policies that are really important and where we see some trends that I think would help. But I want to start by putting a little bit of reality out there. Not a doom and gloom reality, but a reality of what we're dealing with right now in the education policy sphere. This is a Gallup poll. It's 50 years of where people think education lies. So over 50 years, you can see it's ebbed and flowed some, but people's perception of education having a great or a really good impact has been about 50% until about 2000 or so, and it's been trending down. It's not where I think all of us would like for it to be, because we understand that without a quality education, something post-high school, whether that's some industry-recognized certificate, community college, an associate's degree, a bachelor's degree, it's going to be hard for people to be successful in the workforce and be meaningful parts of their community. This is a really important graph because I want you to understand that I'm going to go through a little bit of where education policy is, and then I want to touch on really 8 big issues: career and tech ed, dual enrollment, career readiness, early college high schools, career pathways, work-based learning opportunities, counseling, and business engagement. Those are the policies that states are doing that are making a major difference for Reach Higher and for many of your states. The difficulty is many of these policies are being put together in pilot programs in districts or high schools and not always statewide because it's hard to do when the leaders in those state positions are changing drastically. I can tell you that as we look back over the last 50 years, we have not seen as much change in education policy leaders as we have seen in the last 2 years. Some of that's elections, some of that's just reality of people getting burnout, but you need to look at where these numbers are. So in 2015, we had 14 new governors who joined. I was at the National Governors Association meeting a year ago. Governor Hickenlooper was there. There were a lot of new governors. I mean, 14 out of 50 is a big transition. But even more important is when you look at some of the other positions. 18% of legislators turned over in the 2014 elections, so starting in 2015. That's 20% of our legislators are freshman legislators. More important for us is the chairs of education committees. You've got 100 chairs of education committees, a Senate and House in each state, usually. Some have a few more, but it's about 100. We have 32% of the chairs of education committees who are brand new in their jobs. This is a reality of changing within our politics and how we're electing people. But if you have 20% of the legislators as freshmen, and you have 30% of the education chairs new in that role, pushing statewide policies is going to take some additional work from all of us. The biggest number, though, is chief state school officers. There was a time not too long ago, about 7 or 8 years ago, where the average tenure of a chief state school officer was 8 years. The average tenure as of last month, because we're checking it by month right now, is 2 years, 4 months. So in 2015, 31 of the 50 chief state school officers started new. They are amazing leaders. They are very educated. They know what they want to do. They're also still trying to figure out where to park their car, how to get their health insurance, who's on their team that works with them and who doesn't. And so these are important questions that you need to be thinking about as you're looking at statewide policies. There were a lot of new higher ed executives out of the 50 and a lot of state board members. There's a couple of other key trends, which is what's going to happen in 2016. There will be at least 6 new governors. In the state of Delaware, Missouri, New Hampshire, North Dakota, Vermont, and West Virginia, those governors are term limited and will not be continuing. In 2016, we also have 6 governors who are up for re-election in some capacity, and some of your states are here with that: Indiana, Montana, North Carolina, Oregon, Utah, and Washington. These are trends that I try to make sure education people like you understand, because sometimes the policies aren't moving because people aren't interested. It's that it's just not the right time as they're transitioning in new roles. In 2016, we also saw 3 new chiefs that were put into place. It's June. We've already had 3 new chiefs on top of the 31 new ones in 2015, and we have 4 interims right now. Colorado is one of those that has an interim that just changed last month. These changes are really important when we look at the sector that we're trying to change in education. The other thing I just say, and it's numbers that I look at a lot when I'm speaking on teacher issues, 5 years ago we looked at studies and there were 750,000 college students who were enrolled in teacher prep programs. So 750,000 students wanted to become teachers 5 years ago. Last year, the number was 499,000. So that's a drop of about a third of the number of college students who are interested in becoming teachers. Now, there's alternative ways to certification, and there are people who are coming in from the workforce, and we support that. But a third is a big change when we're looking at the needs that we have within the schools. So what I want to highlight as I go into some of these policies, and what I'm going to do is give you a quick overview of the policy, but talk about a state or two that we think is doing it right or has some areas where you can learn. On all of these components, I want you to be thinking a little bit about these 4 areas. The most successful programs we're seeing in states tackle all of these: student readiness, access, quality, and alignment. Governor Hickenlooper talked about some of the policies here in Colorado, and I'm going to highlight a few of them. But a lot of the policies Colorado looked at were really around access and alignment problems, which they had identified. The student readiness and the quality weren't as big of an issue. And so in each of your states, it's going to be different. But these are the 4 issues that differentiate states that are seeing dramatic changes in the goals of Reach Higher and states that are having some impediments in getting there. So I want to start with career and tech ed and dual enrollment, because I think they're 2 of the biggest policies that we're seeing across the country in the states. Career and tech ed is extremely important. And I have to tell you that good, high-wage, high-demand jobs in this country will continue to go unfilled when we look at the data. And local, state, and national economic growth and competitiveness will not be achieved until young people, parents, school, staff, and others advising students on their post-secondary and career options understand that there are really good jobs, great career potentials that may be achieved through industry certification, apprenticeships, or mentoring. We've had a couple of crazy stories from school counselors who've called us. Jennifer Zinth in my office runs our high school institute. She got a call from one school counselor who was just kind of sharing issues, but The school counselor had a student who took an assessment test that said career in tech ed is probably the best goal for this student. It would fit their needs and help them to be successful. The call, though, was from a mother who wanted the password for her son's test so that she could change the answers because she didn't want him going to a CTE program. This is the perception that we're seeing in a lot of areas across the country. And until we change that perception, we're not going to be able to meet the goals that we have. We see a lot of CTE programs that have been worked on over decades, so don't get me wrong here. But it wasn't until about 2013 that we started to see states that were actually working on aligning career and tech ed programs with workforce needs. Talked with the Secretary of Commerce in Kentucky a couple of years ago. They had an entire career and tech ed facility they built, and they built it based on what the administrators thought was needed, and it really didn't teach what the workforce needed there, and they had to revamp everything before they got the students in. That alignment started to happen in states in 2013. And there's a host of states that have really done a good job in aligning curricular offerings and career pathways with state or regional workforce needs. Some of the states we promote to other states include Alabama, Florida, who's here, Indiana, North Carolina, who's here. And then there's also some states that have found a way to invest money in some of these opportunities for career and tech ed. They've actually found a way to put incentives that are down there for completing industry credentials. Kansas, Minnesota, Oklahoma, and Texas are states that have done that. I can tell you in Kansas there, and I'm from Kansas, spent 20 years there working in the governor's office, there are actually financial incentives that have been put down for some agriculture jobs. So if the high school does this the right way with the career and tech ed centers and gets a full credential for a student in that industry, the high school actually gets money for that. And so it's a great way to try to promote some of these programs if you have that opportunity. I'd urge you to take a look at a couple of reports we have on our website at ecs.org. Again, this is part of the reporting aspect of what we do for education leaders like you. But we actually have a couple of reports. One is on aligning K-12 and post-secondary career pathways with workforce needs. And the other is on targeted programs and career pathways within workforce development policies. Again, these are 8 to 10 page reports that highlight what states are doing well and the questions you ought to be asking if you're going to be putting a policy into place. Dual enrollment is the number one issue that people search on our website for. It's not high school graduation rates, it's not kindergarten, it's not bullying, it's actually dual enrollment. And I can tell you that this is a great big issue that we are seeing across all the states. Governor Brian Sandoval, Republican of Nevada, was our chair previously. This was a big issue for him. And our current chair is Governor Steve Bullock of Montana, and he has made dual enrollment his chair's initiative for the next 2 years. And I want to start by telling you a little story about Tyler. Tyler is 19 now. But Tyler went to high school and graduated last May, not last month, but last year. He graduated from Allen Central High School in rural Kentucky. I was actually connected with Tyler because the chief state school officer contacted a principal who contacted a counselor who set me up to have a call with Tyler. Tyler's high school is not the high school that you would assume is going to have students going on to college, just by the numbers. It's a small high school, 400 students total in the high school. Free and reduced lunch numbers in that school are 77%. So it's very rural, very low income. And you can tell by the numbers of the research that's out there, that's the line that's in green, it is those low income, rural high schools that have the lowest college going rate. And that is taken by, they graduate in May, did they register for some post-secondary program by August the next year? So by the numbers, Tyler shouldn't be one going to college. But what's amazing is Tyler graduated at the end of May last year with a high school degree, and at the beginning of May, Tyler had an associate's degree. And that wasn't because there was a state policy in the state yet. That was because of a counselor who had done a lot of work with her principal and school board to create kind of this great synergy between Allen Central High School and the Big Sand Community and Technical College. You see, Tyler was still a high school student for his entire 4 years. He went to prom, he went to football games, he was there for lunch. But he also took 67 credit hours between the community college and his high school. Some taken at the high school where the professors came over to teach. Some he went to the community college for. And Tyler wasn't alone in that capacity because Tyler's graduating class was 70-some, and Tyler actually had about 16 students who had associate's degrees before they got their high school degree. Tyler wouldn't have achieved this if it wasn't for his school counselor, Sandy Mullins. And I've talked with Sandy a lot, and I've talked with Tyler a lot. Okay, I haven't talked with Tyler a lot. I have to text him because he doesn't answer his phone. And if I text about 11:30 at night, my time, it's later for him, he's back home, and he does text me back. But Tyler wouldn't have had that opportunity if it wasn't for a counselor and if it wasn't for people investing in what he really needs to get done. Tyler was most proud, though, that he is the first in his family to have any post-secondary education. And Tyler just completed, at the age of 19, his junior year at the University of Kentucky, where he was accepted into the School of Engineering and Management. Tyler's why you do every day, but it's not necessarily a story understood by policymakers at the state level all the time. On dual enrollment, we continue to see a lot of really interesting programs that are out there. And two states I'd urge you to look at are Iowa and Colorado. I can tell you that the National Alliance of Concurrent Enrollment Partnerships estimates that last year, approximately 2 million public high school students were taking dual and concurrent enrollment courses. So that's 13% of the high school students were doing that. But Iowa is a state that's totally blown things out of the water. I mean, in Iowa's case, they actually had 30% of their students taking something at a community college or others. And that's really done because of some synergies that they've pushed from a state level. Colorado, I'd urge you to look at for alignment issues. Colorado had a lot of discrepancies as early back as 2009, where even if you took dual enrollment courses in some of the high schools, they weren't necessarily transferable the same way. There was an agreement and even some pressure from the legislature and executive branch to bring certain courses to where curriculum was accepted by everyone in Colorado. I love that bill because I have two high school students here who are taking dual enrollment courses, but that alignment issue is key to making sure that students who invest in taking some post-secondary courses are going to have it transferable. I'd like for you to also look at our website for a report we've done on 13 model policies for state-level components. I can tell you that these model policies are what we've seen across the country and we use with a lot of legislators. In Kentucky, when we released this in 2013, the chief state school officer called us and said he doesn't have the authority to implement it all. And so he went to the chairs of his education committee and asked them to pass a resolution urging him to set up a committee based on that report. So these are key model policies that we've seen in states that have made a major transition in outcomes on dual enrollment. And so it's a report that you should utilize in any way. The next six I want to talk about a little quicker, and they're all around career readiness, which is really about providing opportunities to better prepare our students for joining the workforce. And this is a really tough transition that we see with parents, because a lot of parents are still thinking about high school as proms and football and basketball, and not always is there an internship opportunity for my junior or senior year for my student to take advantage of. One of the policies that we've seen states do really well with is in early college high schools. And there's about 12 states that actually have statewide policies around this that you should look at. Early college high schools guarantee that at your sophomore or junior year, if your grades are at a certain point and you have teachers who think you can handle this, you start to move into taking some additional classes. Most early college high schools are set up for low-income communities, and they have a big impact in those areas. And if you stay for 5 years, you have an associate's degree. I would tell you North Carolina and Texas have some of the policies that are great for you to look at. I can also tell you early college high schools are really tough for state education agencies. They get really mad when people are staying a fifth year and just taking a couple of high school courses and still getting state funding, but not meeting a four-year graduation rate. And so we've worked with a lot of states to go in and change the way they're counting their graduation rate to allow students to succeed in a higher way. Oregon was not allowing anything to move really quick, and then we worked with them on how to redo some of that policy. It's an important aspect that provides many students an opportunity they would not get unless it was there in that high school. Career pathways is a big issue, and we see a lot of programs that are taking place across the country to really align career pathway programs. Colorado, again, has done a lot on this. Nationally, we see in a lot of instances, though, career pathways have some dilemmas. One is that the high school programs are not well aligned with the post-secondary programs. And if you're not having those conversations, it's going to be difficult. The second is that high school and post-secondary programs are not well aligned with the business community and their needs. And the third is that new career pathways are not being developed at the rate the market is looking at them. Colorado actually retooled some career pathways in 2013 with some legislation, and based on the success of that effort in 2015, as the governor was talking about, the legislature asked to redesign additional career pathways in construction, related skill trades, information technology, and healthcare over the next several years. Again, we've got two reports that are on our website, which I think give you a really good way to see what other states are doing, because you don't have to be the expert on career pathways if you're able to look at what another state did and learn from that experience. Work-based learning opportunities is a great area where states are starting to jump a lot, and we've seen a lot more work on this in the last 2 years, 2015 and 2016. Tennessee and Utah are two states that have not only done a lot of work, but they've also done some really good work in putting together reports that would be good for you to look at. Tennessee's Work-Based Learning Implementation Guide is one that we use in a lot of states. You may not have the same state as Tennessee, but there's a lot of good things for you to learn out of that report. Utah does the same thing with their Career Council. It's a guide to talent attraction and development for Indiana employers, and it's one of the best at really saying we need the business community and we need the school leaders to actually be talking before we start to put a program together. I can tell you on counseling and career exploration, this is an area that is difficult. Eric talked about the numbers of counselors and how that's difficult. I can tell you of our three kids, we have two that are in high school, and their counselor to student ratio is 415-1. And that makes it really difficult. If my doctor ratio was the same way, I'd be very upset. But we seem to be okay in some states for that counselor ratio to be that high, and that needs to change. As astronaut Sally Ride famously said, you can't be what you can't see. Students can't aspire and prepare for careers that they don't even know exist. And we see a lot of opportunities in states where, as you're taking some of the counseling and changing it and providing career exploration opportunities, it's a whole new ballgame for those students. Texas and Utah are, again, two states that I would highlight. Utah actually established a competitive grant program for local education agencies to actually pay course fees for their counselors to earn a certificate certifying that a school counselor is highly skilled at providing college and career counseling. And that's a great way to have an investment in the professional development for what you're doing so well. On business engagement, which is one of my last, there are a lot of states that are trying this, but it's really hard to get the engagement. When I was in Kansas, we established the Business Education Partnership. The downside was it was a lot more business and a lot less education. To build these kind of coalitions, you've really got to have leadership from the top in your state, and you've got to have complete buy-in. We see states where the buy-in is coming from the businesses, but the education community is thinking of it as another task force or something. They're not really investing like this is going to be our number one goal for the next 2 years. Indiana has done a lot of great work on this. They were one of the first states to really look at business engagement through a major committee they set up, and in 2013, they put it in statute to establish regional partnerships between school districts, post-secondary representatives, and business and industry leaders. When you have a state like what Indiana did that pushes this through the state law and actually sets something up that makes it meaningful for businesses and schools to engage, you're probably going to have a much better conversation about what you want to achieve. So that's a big picture view of some of the major policies that we're seeing across the state. You all do amazing work in your states. You're going to be able to learn a lot from each other in the next few days. But I'd urge you to look at our website or pull down some of that information or even just call us and say, I want to know more about what you talked about in Utah or Tennessee or Indiana or Colorado. Because the best way we're going to have the best policy to really make programs like Reach Higher succeed is when we're learning from each other on how we can not make the same mistakes other states may have made. So I'm happy to take a few questions if you have any before we have the panel introduced. Well, if you have any later on once the coffee is set in, I'm still going to be up here a little bit. So thank you very much, and I'll turn it back over to Eric to introduce our panel.
All right, if the panels can just come up, we're going to have Joe Varangia, the Global Director for Corporate and Social Responsibility from Arrow Electronics, Noel Ginsberg, the President of Intertech Plastics and Chair of the Governor's Business and Experiential Learning Commission. We've got Josh Craver, Vice President of Talent Management from Western Union, and also Carl Marchetto, Vice President and General Manager, Commercial Space Systems Company, Lockheed Martin. Can we give them a round of applause, please? And we can bring back our friend Jeremy.
A
Well, it's an honor to have all four of you here, and I think it's going to be a great opportunity for everyone to learn a lot about the specific programs that you've been working on and where your investments have been, not only as business leaders, but also as community leaders. And so why don't we go ahead and start off, Joe, with you with a little bit of a background on kind of where your energy has been focused in the last few years and where the priorities are.
Good morning, everybody. I'm Joe Varengia, and I am Global Director of Corporate Social Responsibility for Arrow Electronics. The shorthand version of that is I'm the company priest. I'm the one person in 18,000 people at Arrow who doesn't have to worry about making a profit. But I do have to worry about making my program relevant to the corporation and helping to move us forward in new ways. Just by a little way of background, we started this program 3 years ago, shortly after we moved our headquarters to Colorado, and Governor Hickenlooper was instrumental in bringing Arrow to Colorado, and since then we've had a very strong partnership on many issues, including education. And as part of moving Arrow here, and by the way, just Arrow is 18,000 people around the world, 460 locations, revenues of $24 billion plus a year. So we're really big and really successful, but we have to change. We have to change because we are in the middle of the electronic supply chain, and that changes all the time. We've talked about disruption here a little bit this morning. We're part of that disruption. We're part of that. We are disrupted every day, and we disrupt every day. And disruption sounds like a negative word, right? Everybody's scared of disruption. So let's change that language today. Let's call it innovation. Innovation is a much more positive word because that's what's happening. And when we moved to Colorado, we were an 80-year-old company that didn't have an identity in the community and in the world other than in the world that we create for ourselves in business. And so we launched a branding initiative both to help redefine ourselves inside so we understood ourselves and how to define ourselves for the outside world. And that includes our future workforce because we're in competition for the same kids that some of the people I'm sharing on the panel are with. So we've agreed to play nice today, but when we leave the room, we're going back at it for the best and the brightest. And so when we adopted this innovation brand program for ourselves and for others, we have a theme or a mission statement, and that is we guide innovators to a better tomorrow. And so we are not the innovators, we're the guides of innovation. We work with the innovators. We have to identify them and then help bring their creations to a commercial reality. And then the tagline is 5 years out. And what does that mean? That's the tangible horizon for the electronics industry. Someone comes to us with an idea that says, well, it's going to take me 10 years, but I really want your help. Well, they might as well be talking about a time machine because 5 years out is about as far out as we can see in terms of where technology is headed. Because you get a new phone every 6 months, right? And it's a little better, a little better. 5 years ago, you didn't have a tablet. 5 years from now, you're going to have something else. So my job is to create programs that help us, in the sense of this conference, find those new workers that can help us. And it's a hybrid worker. We don't have factories. We contract manufacture. And we have engineers, but we also have salespeople. We have to have people who understand both the engineering side of electronics and this rapid turnover of sales and the iteration of new designs into new devices. So we really need innovative employees now as well as working with the innovators. So where my program is headed, and then I'll take a breath and let somebody else talk, is that we started very traditionally because Arrow is a big aircraft carrier of a company, and now we're trying to turn that aircraft carrier. So we have internships. And we used to have internships that were like my internship a long time ago, which is basically you got the worst work and you worked really hard and you worked at night and you worked on weekends. Now our internship program is more like going to an all-inclusive. And I'm pretty jealous of it. The problem with that is that when we hire 98% of our interns, it's a really great program, but then they go right onto a work team and they're responsible for P&L. They're part of a team that's responsible for that, and it's like getting smacked. And within 2 years, we lose a lot of them because it's not the all-inclusive. So without losing the benefits of that, we need to turn our internship program into something that is more like work, and we have to make work more inspiring as well. Then the second part of that is we have scholarships like a lot of companies. And what we found out was that, for instance, when we're recruiting engineers, and this is a true story, when I got to Arrow, I thought it was an Arrow urban legend, but it is true. We were lucky enough to get a highly recruited, highly sought after engineering candidate to actually come to us. And we were thrilled. And first meeting this young man who knew everything about electrical engineering actually said, "What's an invoice?" And well, the reaction in the room was just like this. And so we realized that we needed to help create hybrid candidates that could take that engineering education and commercialize it, because that's what we do. And so we created scholarships for engineers at Colorado universities that gave them business skills, that we would pay for their business education as well. Now we've learned that the education curriculum is so demanding that they have to take an extra year to use our scholarship and get business training. And if they say, well, if I'm going to do that, why don't I just get an MBA? Because then I'll have a master's degree. So we're in the process of trying to adjust that. You see, it's always working on the fly. And so now I'm moving my program focus more towards how do we actually teach innovation? And I'll stop there, but I'll drop the name Tony Wagner. You know, he's a disruptor out of Harvard right. University. And Tony and I talk a lot. That's where I want to go. Next.
So Josh, do we just go down the line? Or Josh, go ahead, and because sure. We had talked about you. Yeah, talk no about problem. Western Union and some of the impact that you're seeing.
Yeah, so Josh Craver, Vice President of Talent Management, and I also run the corporate university for Western Union. Western Union has offices in over 200 countries and provinces. Probably you might not even think we have that many countries in the world. Our workforce is 11,000 full-time employees and about 10,000 contingent labor. We also have an agent model, so we have over 500,000 agent locations around the world. And we move money 29 times every second. So we're in the financial services business. And right now, the speed of change will never be as slow as it is today. We lose 30% of our new hires every year. We hire about 4,000 people. So that's incredible to manage. So we're just trying to figure out, how do we get people in, educate them, and continue to help them learn and grow so they stay? It's a big problem.
That is, without a doubt. Noel, talk to us a little bit about your experience, not only in starting the company, but with the workforce issues.
Well, I started my company when I was in college. It was a class project that turned into a business, and in fact, I'm probably the only one on the panel that doesn't have a degree, because I left in my senior year to run my business. It was, one was paying the bills and school wasn't. But what I learned is that being able to go to school and work at the same time gave me a level of experience and understanding that has really driven what I've done for the rest of my career and in my community engagement. Because when you're learning in a classroom the theory and you're able to apply that in practice, it makes a big difference. So as president and CEO of Intertech Plastics, it's a manufacturing company. And certainly, throughout our years, the biggest challenge I've had in good times and bad was to have a skilled workforce able to drive the technology forward, to operate our equipment, to build molds, to do the things you do in manufacturing. And so for 36 years, the same problem has existed for me. And as part of that issue, it's driven me and our corporate responsibility into our community. I've spent time teaching classes for 3 or 4 years at Montbello High School, getting to understand what it's like to teach. And I can tell you, I don't know how teachers do it. Just handling one class once a week, developing the curriculum and delivering it is not an easy thing. But what I learned is when you connect what's happening in the workplace, so they know what an invoice is, they're actually better able to prepare themselves for the world of work. So the alignment of my business and my community work has brought me to believe that business has a different role than we've had in the past. And it's really driven the work that I've done for the state of Colorado. 2 years ago, I was asked to chair the CTE Council for Denver Public Schools. And as a part of that, a year ago, next week, I was invited to attend a 12-day institute in Switzerland to learn about the Swiss apprenticeship system. And frankly, when I went there, I expected to learn about how they do apprenticeships in the trades, how they do it when students are have already graduated from high school. What I didn't expect is what I saw. And what I saw is a system that starts early on in middle schools where they do in-depth career exploration. So students have an opportunity to know what it is they might be interested in. And counselors are key to that process. But when they enter the 11th grade, they have a choice to either continue with traditional education or go into an apprenticeship of their choice. And 70% of their population does just that. The other thing I didn't expect is that the president of UBS was an apprentice. The Secretary of Education in Switzerland did an apprenticeship in banking, that in fact their apprenticeship system covers 230 different occupations across their entire economy. And so if you want to be a ski instructor, there's an apprenticeship. If you want to run a bank or go into banking, there's an apprenticeship. So it changed my view. And when I learned that they spend 2 days in a classroom and 3 days actually in business learning about what that invoice is, it changes outcomes. And what's that outcome? In that country, their unemployment rate is 2.6% for youth, 18 to 26. Think about that. In some of our inner cities right now, it's 30% if you're a minority. More than that, when they finish that apprenticeship, they enter into a $50,000 to $55,000 a year job. 70% of their population goes through that apprenticeship. So it's a system that serves all of their people. And if you decide to do an apprenticeship and then get your four-year degree, you'll earn 30% more upon graduation from college because of the applied learning that you've had. You know how to, you know the theory, but you know how to apply it. So it was a system that after 11 days of seeing something work at a country scale, we came up with a decision that we needed to bring our leadership back from Colorado. We asked the governor to lead that delegation. We brought 48 leaders from Colorado there in January to learn about that system. And then to help us design what that model will look like in Colorado, not for Denver, but for the entire state, to serve all children, to make sure that they have a choice, and for business to have an insight into the talent pipeline that isn't, we get to tell the schools what you need to do and then we can sit back as critics. The reality of it is we have a role to play. And that is by extending the classroom into our businesses so that students can learn the theory and practice. No longer can we just be consumers of the education process. We need to be producers as well. And the system we're looking to build in Colorado will do just that. And I think the closing piece for this and for all the businesses that will be involved in this in the future is this isn't philanthropy. We don't work through the foundation side of businesses. We work through the human resource department. Because the research that's been done in Switzerland will tell you, the businesses that do this, that it's profitable. After 4 years of an apprenticeship in Intertech, cost me $100,000 in 4 years to do an apprentice in tool making, I will have made that back through the productive work of that apprentice so that in fact it's break even when they graduate. If they stay with me, it's highly profitable because they know my systems, they know how to do the job, they earned while they learned, and they have a really bright future. So for business, we have to think differently, and we have to understand this isn't about philanthropy. This is good for the students, and it's good for our businesses. If we're going to compete globally, it's no longer going to be about what our wages are. It's going to be how capable is our workforce. And we're losing that battle. And it's time that we change.
And if I may, Noel and I were talking before, and I talked about the attrition of 30%, and I talked about the hiring of almost 4,000 new employees and how devastating that is to our cost base. And if we can get, the reason we're losing people is they don't have the skills. And they haven't been trained properly. They're coming out of schools with skills that aren't applicable in the workforce. And so as we put them in that model, they're not set up for success. So this type of partnership
is beneficial for both. And I think one of my key takeaways for everyone here is get closer to your business communities, partner with them, understand their needs, and there's a lot of shared value that can be created.
Carl, talk a little bit about Lockheed Martin. I mean, it's not exactly a small company that was just started. So talk about your issues and how that's evolving.
Good morning, everyone. Carl Marchetto. I operate inside of a very interesting technology company called Lockheed Martin. There are about 120,000 of us. We're growing. We do great things across this nation. And we're moving out into the global network at great pace. The part of the business that I've been associated with for my whole career has been around launching satellites in orbit. And the environments that we have to think about and the types of companies that we compete against. It's quite interesting. So we're a global company. The types of satellites that I'm involved with are and my team's involved with are all about remote sensing, taking pictures of the Earth, weather, Google Earth, and also all of the communication satellites that you use every day, maybe to listen to NBC or on our satellites. We've got close to 48 of them flying. Most of those we talk about, and many, many more that we don't talk about that provide you with GPS and finding your way here to this great university today. I have worked in 7 different companies in my career. My career started out of an engineering school in New Jersey, but the opportunity that I took was to become an engineer in training in my first job because I wanted to learn about the rest of the company. And I would offer that to you as trainers of these great people, these stewards of these responsibilities, to think about how do we bring our folks forward into thinking about the art of the possible. Our workforce right now, we talk about engineers that are in different disciplines, we talk about cyber capability, but more importantly, we're trying to build a business acumen thought process with them. It's to start to think about P&L, start to think about profit and loss. It's to think about this competitive nature that we're in. To think about how do we sell the next satellite in Europe against a company that's based there, Airbus. Very capable company. How do we bring our understanding of what those customer needs need to be? How do we work as a team with perseverance that will push through to think about what the art of the possible is? So as I think about my colleagues that are up here, we have a great job. We work on some really cool stuff. You think The Martian was, the movie was cool with Matt Damon? We live it every day. And so I think, how do we encourage our employees to stay with us? It's, why are they relevant? Do they really understand the impact that they're making on an outcome? What is that outcome? Is it to put someone on Mars? Is it to put the next GPS satellite up? Is it to come up with the next remote sensing satellite that will predict the next tornado or the next hailstorm within 15 minutes? That relevancy, I think, is what motivates all of us through our whole career, whether it's our first job or our last job. So I think that people that we work with at early stages, people that come out of STEM, they come into our industry, they're going to pull down 6 figures, starting. $125,000 a year is the norm. How do we keep them engaged with what's relevant and important and driving ultimately shareholder value and customer experience? Is all about them keeping engaged with what we think is a broader opportunity than becoming just a mechanical engineer. I think there's a lot more to it than just the discipline that they made it come out of college with, is to think about what's the relevance of that, what's the ultimate purpose, and where's that going to lead us. So you have a tremendous responsibility in doing the work that you're doing. It's not only a social set of skills that you have to help these folks out with, because a lot of them may not have those skills. And if they don't have those skills to interact with people, you know, it's going to be difficult for them to continue to go forward. So with that, it's a great place. Bring your students. We have open doors. We're very much involved. Lockheed is very much involved with a lot of different programs. I think we've invested close to $1 million here in the state alone. And I think that if there is an opportunity I have had in my career to mentor a handful of people, please contact me personally. And I will get involved, have conversations. It's the art of the possible. We have to educate these folks, these young students, with what's available to them. What kinds of problems can they be involved with that will change the outcome of the world? It's an awesome opportunity to be able to shape people at such a young age. Thank you.
Well, I think your comments on the art of the possible. I think your comments on the art of the possible are really relevant here. And I think that's what we see across the country and some of the disconnect between, are we educating the students to what they need to be a major part of the workforce and to be able to make that transition immediately, or are we not? So what I'd like to do is have each of you comment and just jump in whenever on, you know, what are you seeing globally, nationally, or even just as important, locally, on the business role in really helping to create that education conversation to happen? I think globally there's some, but there's a lot more happening locally that we're seeing.
Well, certainly what we're trying to do through the Bell Commission is to create, you talked about alignment of business to the education process. Typically, those conversations typically happen once a year. We share with you kind of our download of what we're interested in. The system that we're building now, the backbone of it is our industry associations, whether it's Colorado Bankers Association or Colorado Technology Association, or the Colorado Advanced Manufacturing Alliance. We are involved in developing the curriculum, the competencies, and the assessments along with the education system so that there's a hard wire to make sure that you're not training what we're not using, that you're training what we are using. And it's not, you know, I hear so many times people point the fingers at education and say you're not doing what we need. Well, the real missing link is not you, it's us. So what we're trying to do in Colorado is hardwire that connection. So it's ongoing, that the curriculum is being developed by industry for use within the apprenticeships, are advising the curriculum that is being used within the classroom, whether that's in the K-12 system or post-secondary, because it's both important. If we do that, we'll ensure that there's jobs available for these students when they graduate and they have the skills that they need to be successful. Now, one of the things you hear about the college student that graduates and can't find a job. The system of apprenticeships that I observed overseas, because it's industry driven, because they have a marketplace for apprenticeships that are posted every year for jobs they look to fill in the next 2 to 4 years, you can't get an apprenticeship for a job that doesn't exist. That means it's market driven, that kids are learning what they're going to need to be successful in something they're passionate about. I can't tell you how many kids I met over there that said, I love what I do. I'm passionate about the work that I'm doing. They're in high school. Imagine that. Imagine a kid, your kid, at 16 or 17, working in a bank. Most of us can't even imagine that. I'll tell you that our kids aren't any different than the Swiss kids or the German kids. Our kids aren't given the opportunity to grow up, to work in a professional environment as a part of their education process. If you do that, they will rise to that occasion. So the point is, we're trying to build a statewide system that is hardwired to the business community, that creates a two-way dialogue continuously, year-round, from now and forever. In the Swiss model, the standards, the curriculum that are created, which is what we will do here, is it revised at least every 4 years, if not sooner. Some industries, the high-tech industry, can change every year, so that dialogue has to happen continuously. So I think there is a way to create those connections, and certainly in Colorado, we're trying to do it at a statewide basis. There are examples around the country of Mercedes working with a specific high school, but there are no system-wide approaches to this, and frankly, so it is profitable for businesses to participate. It has to be statewide, and ultimately, I think we need a national policy around this. Apprenticeships aren't what we thought of them in the past. There's something very new and very contemporary that can, I believe, make a big difference to the outcomes with our students.
And I think the comment Carl made about the art of possible. We need to get together, you know, educators, policymakers, corporations, businesses, and talk about what's possible more. Those conversations are not happening enough. And we have, through our HR organizations, through our foundation, we have a lot of resources and a lot of opportunities to collaborate. But from our perspective, we're oftentimes not aware of what's possible. And when we hear what's possible, what we heard earlier, or we hear what's possible from Noel, we get energized and excited and look to align resources. But really, those conversations about the art of possible need to happen more.
The other thing I would like to comment on is the responsibility we have to help our young students start to understand the responsibility of a work ethic. I think, you know, in this new communication mode that we're in, and the texting and the way they like to communicate, we like to communicate. But I think there's a balance of interacting with people that can't be overlooked. The social skills can't be overlooked. The debate, the healthy debate about what we think possible is, or what outcomes should we work on as a team, what's important. I think these are things these are all part of the educational model that I worry about, that if there isn't a work ethic, I've conducted business in almost every country of the world. And when I go to Asia, I get a different work ethic than when I'm in Paris or when I'm in the UK. And it's very, very interesting about what is viewed as important, what's urgent, what's focused on, and then maybe when I work in Pennsylvania or United or New Jersey or so on and so forth. So these models about urgency, expectation, collaboration, or team, working as a team, respect, along with these aligned principles that Noel is talking about, I think that's all part of great outcomes. And I worry that sometimes if we may just focus on one side of this, we may get kids that are extremely bright but can't function in the real world. We're cycling at every 3 months a new consumer product. I used to work at Eastman Kodak. Four generations of family worked in Rochester, New York. Four generations. What was the second generation going to do? They were going to work on the film plant, in the film plant. You want to think about, how do we break out of that? How did we change some outcomes because people were going to do this over and over again? So each state that I worked in had a different nuance to it. So the world is like this. How are we going to prepare? I think some of our greatest successes in business came from bringing the outside into the building. What was really happening in Asia, where my team didn't know about it, yet we had to compete against them. Mm-hmm. Our greatest accomplishments came from educating our own folks about what was happening outside the building. And then they started to realize, this is really what's going on. I have to figure my way through this. Not this sheltered approach. We have to open them up.
And what's possible from our perspective, one of the things we're doing well is mentoring. Hmm. So you talk about the power of the counselor and their impact and the dearth of them and how many more, if you have them, the better success for your students. We do really good mentoring. I've been mentoring a child in high school from freshman year to graduation this summer, and he failed his junior year, and we worked through that, and he walked the stage last month, and it was a great moment for him, first person in his family ever to graduate from high school. I personally got a lot out of that and learned, and we do that with our youth here in Denver and in Colorado, and we help them learn about what's it like in the real world, and what does it look like to have work ethic. Come to work and shadow us and see what it's like. And I think mentoring for your youth, and it's a huge part of realizing what's going on in the work world and how to learn from people that have been there and done that. And it's really gratifying for us as well. We learn a lot through the process.
Josh, you talk a little bit about the school counselor and the effect that you had, and the chancellor spoke on that.
I mean, can any of you comment about what you've seen that has really worked from professional school counseling and what you're trying to achieve? And I think just as important, are there actions or policies that have been inhibiting some of the growth that you'd like to have in interacting with these future employees?
I think one of, you know, the governor mentioned the Denver Scholarship Foundation, and I'd like to give them a plug as well. I mean, when we, you know, Arrow doesn't have a foundation, so when we make a donation, and it's coming from, you know, not a special reserved part of the company. It's coming from our operating money, and so, you know, that's why we make those decisions pretty carefully, we make them according to a set of criteria that really has to reflect this innovation principle and where we want to go. And what the Denver Scholarship Foundation does that appealed to us, that attracted us, is that they stay with those scholars while they're in college. It's not, okay, here's your money to go to college, and we counseled you through that process, we helped you pick a major and find a place to go, now go. Well, that's, the dropout rate in college, doing it that way, is like 80%. You know, they've turned that around because they stay with those kids, and the foundation that supported them in high school continues to support them through college and helps them navigate the whole thing. Not just the academics, but how to make a schedule, you know, how to go to class, how to get to class, the social aspects of that as well. Being on a new campus when you're the first kid in your family, and you can't ask anybody at home for advice about how to do that. And they have a graduation rate of 80% as a result of that. So really, they're not doing a four-year process, they're doing like an eight-year process. So that is one very specific way that we decided that this is where we wanted to go with that, and we think it's a good model that we'd like to grow. I think the other part that I would like to say that, and honestly, we are just at the beginning of this, so I don't have any specifics to show you, is that when you look at how innovation might be taught, you know, the list of those skills is very different than the list of classes that I took, and a lot of it is what's on the list of what we've all talked about this morning. And I think that where the counselor comes in, while we might be trying to adjust the curriculum, is to help. Boy, I'm making it up now as I go, but really help with the guidance of what I guess in business we would call the soft skills that we don't necessarily even yet reward in our own annual evaluation processes, but we are realizing are critical to successful employees and our financial success. And just to give you the list that I've got, critical thinking, collaboration, leading by influence, agility, entrepreneurship, communication, creativity. Mm-hmm. Nobody graded me on that in school, and quite frankly, nobody grades me at Arrow on that. Yet, it's what I do, and it's what engineers do, and it's what sales managers do. So that's where, as counselors, as educators, and as companies, that's where I think we have to talk.
I'll get the statistic wrong. You may know the answer to this. I think you spoke to it earlier, but I think in Denver, we have one counselor to 300 students. That's about that. Mm. So when you ask the question, what can counselors do, I would really say, what can we do as citizens to say that's just not acceptable, that you need... You need ratios that make sense. Counseling in the model that I saw is so powerful and so intense for every child. So the fact that it's 1 in 300, that just doesn't work. What I will share with you, though, is one of the things I was a part of here in Colorado is the formation of the Colorado I Have a Dream Foundation over 30 years ago. If you're not familiar with it, we adopt inner city kids, high dropout schools, when they're in the third grade, and we stay with them till they graduate from high school and provide them a college scholarship. So I was one of the founders of that organization, but about 18 years ago, my wife and I adopted our own class of 42 kids from the South Lincoln Housing Project, a neighborhood with a 90% dropout rate. So when you talk about counseling, what we did for a decade was stayed with those kids, dealt with their issues, went to parent-teacher conferences, made sure that they had the tutoring, And from a 90% dropout rate, we graduated 90% of our kids. And what that lesson taught me is that every child can succeed. And that if you give them the right kind of support, the right exposure, the right opportunities, they will succeed. And one of those kids who was in our class started coming to work with me when he was 12. He's 32 today. He went to the U.S. Navy. He got his undergraduate degree. When he graduated, my wife and I and our kids went out there to surprise him at his graduation in South Carolina and encourage him to come back to Intertech. Navy wasn't for him for the rest of his life. He is now earning well over six figures for a company that we sold a brand to, and he has three kids. He got his master's degree while he was working with us. First person in his family to get a high school degree, a college degree, a master's degree. So when you see the possibilities of what counseling can do, because really that's what I Have a Dream was, it was staying with those kids for 10 years, not abandoning them, making sure that they had a future, you can change outcomes. Margaret Mead was right. You can change the world. And sometimes it's just the power of one working with somebody else. You experienced that, Josh, with the mentoring that you did. That's what counselors do. That's what I think we have an obligation as a society, as a community, to make sure that all kids do have those opportunities.
And I think I'll give you a little bit of a different slant. I think the one-on-one mentoring and counseling is extremely valuable. When you can't give that because of constraints, financial or, you know, human resources, technology is a great way to consider scaling counseling or mentoring. We do it in a corporate, an organization setting with you know, video cameras and a web X where people meet virtually. You can see each other, and you're getting a mentoring circle together. So one senior person, eight junior people, all see each other virtually on a technology platform and are talking about issues and challenges that are relevant to everyone. And oftentimes one person will bring up a topic and it's fruitful for everyone to discuss. And so with counseling, I'm not sure if anyone is exploring using technology, which your youth are used to scale and to get people together and at least give them something. Because oftentimes you can't get the one-to-one. Explore that as an opportunity to try to scale counseling, because the numbers that you have right now are pretty depressing in terms of the ratios. So that would be one piece of advice.
We're going to open this up for questions from the audience. So if you have some, please raise your hand and we'll get a microphone out there. But before we do, I want to jump to a question for the four of you on really the difficulty that have been there with getting some of these partnerships started with business and with education. I mean, a lot of the entities that are doing this are pilot projects with good leadership from the community, but it's sometimes difficult to have them coming as a statewide policy. I know Noel's working here in Colorado, there's some other states, but it's really a bigger haul when you're looking at it to cover all students in a state. So what advice can you share with the audience on how business-led conversations can really make a difference in those partnerships versus maybe what we see in some states where it's executive branch or the legislature or maybe a chief state school officer trying and having some difficulties at times?
I guess I'll start. you know, it's interesting. 2 years ago, right after the governor was elected for a second term, we had a conversation over the weekend on a Sunday. And I was sharing with him what our vision was for workforce development within the Colorado Advanced Manufacturing Alliance, the concept of apprenticeships and extending the classroom. And rather than saying, you know, that's a great thing and we'll adopt that in government, what he said to me is, I think that's a great idea, and you should do it, and I'll support that. So what's the difference there? The difference is you need a champion from industry that's willing to take this on. This has to be driven by us. It's our responsibility. Then, when you then marry that with, in our case, a governor that is as engaged as the business community is to drive this forward, who's willing to have his workforce cabinet, create a workforce cabinet, and create a commission through an executive order that says we're going to align the various state agencies, look at our existing resources, how can we better align them without going to the public and saying give us more money, let's see if we can better spend the dollars that we have. And then if we do that, we might want to go and ask for more money. So I think having a business champion is critical. It is a heavy lift, but it is worth it. And then once you have that champion, usually your political leaders and your schools, everybody will listen when we show up at the table. Mm-hmm. What they're used to is we show up for about 3 months, mm-hmm. and then we get bored and we go back to our offices and kind of forget about it. We have to stay in this fight until we've won the war and built the system so it's self-sustaining. So I think it starts with a champion and then looks to the public sector to join and partner with us.
And I think the reality that we're facing now is we cannot afford, from a education perspective, a business perspective, you know, a state perspective, to not partner more. So imagine a room like this for your state where you had representatives with power from corporations, from government, from education, and your sole focus was on how to create those partnerships, on what was needed for the state. You get those people in a room together, as Noel was saying, and you have a productive, facilitated conversation, you can make things happen.
Any questions that you have from the audience? Got a couple of, we have a microphone that we can, we've got some hand, okay.
Just while the microphone is finding a question, I would offer that this counseling role that you take doesn't stop here. Believe it or not, we're in that same counseling role with professionals. When we come to work, I worry about the employees that aren't not having the best day they can have. Because that's really the asset that we have at Lockheed. It's not the buildings. It's not the special vacuum chambers that we test things in at outer space limits. It's really about the employees wanting to come to work to be the best they can. And when they're not, I think it's my responsibility to try and find out if it's inside the workplace. If it's outside the workplace, I don't know if I can do too much about it, or they're not trained properly, or they're in the right wrong role. But I think this counseling role, I think, is a continuum. It may be called leadership, maybe in higher levels of business, but I think what you folks start here, we can learn from as business leaders, and we have to steward these resources going forward to it. They crash, they hit the wall many times too. We put them in new roles, we think they're gonna do well, and not necessarily the case, but we know they're committed to the end product, and we gotta find a new way for them. So counseling, coaching, mentoring, I think it's really taking the front seat of a successful business.
We've got a question over here. If you could give us your name and at least the state you're with, that'd be helpful.
Bridget, I'm from Oregon, and I appreciate the comments about business engagement and private sector-led partnerships. Could any of you speak to policies or practices that you have in place about diversifying your workforce and creating a more of an equity lens?
So I
rep the priest.
The priest, yeah. Wow. It's, you know, Arrow is a sales company, but it's in the, you know, the business of IT, and IT has a long way to go in diversity. You know, I'll brag on Arrow a little bit just to say that from a leadership perspective, not only do we have a third representation on our board of directors is women, but on our 7-member leadership team, 2 of the top executives in the company are women, including our chief strategy officer. And there's an actual, you know, there's an official program at Arrow from, you know, led by them to diversify our, you know, our workforce, and especially at the middle management level. How do you get to be from manager to director? That's our, you know, that's the ceiling or the barrier at Arrow right now in terms of, you know, what we've been able to identify. So as we move forward, and especially here in Colorado, because we've moved our headquarters here, you know, we're focusing very specifically on the universities in Colorado first before we branch out. So a lot of it is you've heard a lot about the counseling and the mentoring here, and really what I'm impressed by is the one-to-one commitment that it often takes. Well, you know, one-to-one doesn't get you very far very fast, and so we are, you know, we're trying to reach out to those campuses, but put people from Arrow on those campuses, let them meet us, and show them the way in. And so we're doing that with a lot of receptions and a lot of opportunities on their campuses to have those conversations and to follow up personally. So we're taking a pretty personal effort at it. I can't cite any particular metrics yet in terms of, you know, we want X percent by X particular year. I don't think we're doing it that way. I think we're doing it in a more organic way.
And similarly, we don't have policies in place. I've been in companies that we have, and it kind of has a adverse impact to what you're trying to achieve. What we do is we educate a lot around the power of diversity, the power of inclusion, the danger of unconscious bias, which we all have as human beings. These are things that are really powerful in changing a culture, and we know in recent current events that we need to be more aware of being inclusive, and when we're not, it creates problems for everyone. So a lot of education on inclusion, unconscious bias, and you actually have stats now. You can go to the Neuroscience Leadership Institute and see that diverse and inclusive organizations outperform those that aren't. It's not easy. The discussions oftentimes are harder, but you get a better outcome. You get that innovation.
I will say one thing about what we're doing that's specific, even without a number attached to it, is, you know, and this happened, you know, early on. It wasn't me that did it. I'm not taking credit for it, but just in terms of timeline, you know, in the last few years, if you're hiring someone or, you know, hopefully promoting from within as well for a particular middle management job, if your pool of finalists isn't diverse and inclusive, you get sent back and said, do it again. You know, so if you don't have a diverse and inclusive mixture to choose from at that level of the final 3 to 5, you're not going forward with that promotion or that hire.
So I would answer it in two ways, at home and at work. At my company, at Intertech, it's embedded within our core values, how we view each other and how we treat each other. And there's 13 core values. I can't go through all of them with you. But I'll tell you, they're really based on what it is to do the right thing, to run an ethical business, and to do things that match both your head and your heart. Your head, is it legal? But in your heart, is it right? And when you do that, what you find is that diversity kind of springs up around you because you're not filtering. You're bringing people in for what they can contribute. The second thing, when I talk about at home, my kids were born right after we adopted the South Lincoln Dreamers. They grew up in a very diverse environment because we were down there typically once a week and our kids were with us. So when they grew up and they went to school and they brought their friends home, man, they were as diverse as you can get in every respect. And that's because they didn't see color, they didn't see sexual orientation, they saw people. And so I think as parents, we have an obligation not just to reflect those values in the workplace, but at home. You know, it's important that our kids and that we notice when we go out to dinner in Denver, we talk about this a lot with some of my African-American friends, is why are there no people of color in this restaurant? What is it about our society that still isn't integrated? So, I mention that because you have to be able to notice it first to recognize that there's an issue. And then you have to live the values that bring in inclusiveness, and it happens at home and at work.
Got another question from the audience.
Yes. Lisa Vosper, I'm from the state of the great state of Louisiana, to which you are all invited. I have several questions, but first I want to start by saying kudos to your companies and the caliber of leadership that you all represent. I'm curious as to whether or not either any of your companies are providing opportunities for, I'm not a school counselor, for professional school counselors to have internships, externships, opportunities to see firsthand what you're doing. I believe that many times it's hard to advise students on things that you don't know, and many of our colleges of education, if they don't have the type of business and industry partnerships that you are sharing, don't even know to share that that is something that needs to happen. So is that happening? And then particularly to Noel, you've really intrigued me with this whole apprenticeship conversation and this expansion of the classroom. I think that's necessary. But when you hear the term apprenticeship, you think of the apprenticeships of old. Mm-hmm. How do we reimagine it? How do we give it a new twist, make it sexier, that we can start to embrace apprenticeship again in the way that you described they're doing in Switzerland? Because I really do believe that that's the key to bringing all of the synergies you've talked about together. Thank you guys very much.
One of the key parts of our initial strategy is around rebranding. And frankly, we've been debating, do we keep the name apprenticeship or do we name it something else? And I think the reality of it is apprenticeships are here to stay, but they do need rebranding, and that happens through education. So we passed in the state of Colorado a bill a year ago of $3 million to help in rebranding and marketing these types of career exploration opportunities for students. So we're beginning to look at how to deploy those dollars, as well as dollars that we're raising for this youth apprenticeship system independently. So I think we have a rebranding opportunity. We need to talk to parents and to students and to say an earn while you learn model is a powerful thing. And it's not just for the trades, because you could be the president of a bank or the president of a company. So that is something that we're aware of. In fact, I was in DC talking with the USDOL about that. Should we change the name? But we really can't, because people understand what apprenticeships are. They just think it's for plumbers. Mm-hmm. Well, it's not. It's for every career. And when we start to launch that, one of the reasons we picked healthcare and banking and finance as one of our initial pathways is because people don't expect, you mean I could be a banker or a finance person through an apprenticeship? So that's how we're beginning to address it.
To your second, first question about involvement, take my name, give me a call. I'll find out what we do at Lockheed. And if it doesn't exist, we'll do one in my organization.
And I love the idea. It's one that I hadn't thought of, and I think, you know, we bring students in all the time. Why don't we bring the counselors?
Me too. Let me know. We'll do it.
I have a question for the audience. We worry about we have some high pace positions. We're building a satellite for a customer, and it's very difficult. It's 24 months, 36 months, long, long days, 12-hour days to lead that. And what I've learned over the years is that and someone gets very good at it, the propensity will be, after we launch that satellite, get that person with that experience and put them back in the breech of the gun and launch them again. It's very difficult because after a while, they'll leave to do something else, and there's a lot of corporate knowledge there. So that's my own little world. I offer to you this question. What do you folks do to prevent burnout? Because you're dealing with such fundamental human issues. How do you network? How do you share ideas? How do you offload some of the things that you're going through? Because they're at family levels, they're at individual levels, they're at poverty levels. If you don't have a way to share or relieve some ideas, I can just imagine that some days you'd like to move on this important role. So offline, maybe at a coffee, I'd like to hear about what you guys do about this.
Great question. This is from the Gulf Coast of the beautiful Sunshine State of Florida. My name is Steve Rior. I'm involved with a Cradle to Career collaborative group called Talent for Tomorrow. And you represent very large firms. Noel, I think your firm punches above its weight, but mm-hmm. The question is, have you seen in your deep commitment to building business education partnerships a way to scale some of these ideas and best practices across hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of small to mid-sized firms? So any strategies in our home communities, a lot of us are made up of 25 employees, 50
recognizing that most jobs in the United States are created by small and mid-sized businesses, your question is really important. And what we know and what I've observed from the system that I saw overseas is you have to put the infrastructure in place first to allow the small businesses to say, I can kind of plug and play and make that work. In the absence of that structure, they really can't. You have some good examples of companies that are forward thinking, but you really can't scale. So our strategy first is working, frankly, with the larger companies, because they get this. They look strategically over the long haul. They have the HR departments that can help build that curriculum and the assessments and the competency work that needs to get done. Then that can be shared with businesses of all size, whether you're a company of 30 or 20 or 5,000. Mm-hmm. But you have to put the infrastructure in place. So our vision and our actions within Colorado, it's what we're in the middle of now, is building that infrastructure so that the small businesses can participate. And we do have some small businesses participating in our pilot. I'll let you know in a year how that's working.
Yeah, and I would just add that if you can come together and identify what the core competencies are for people to be successful across different industries or business lines, and you can say if they go through one of these programs, they will have these people skills or these core skills that are transferable across industries, that's maybe one way that you can attract them to partner.
I think that for a company like Arrow, which is a sales company, that we have a certain convening power that we can use, because we have 100,000 customers, some of them very large, like Lockheed, thank you, and some of them as small as what you've been describing or smaller. And so we can't compel anybody to do anything, but my program, you know, we operate under a concept known as shared values, where we try to develop projects and support initiatives, and we try to bring customers and suppliers with us, partly, quite frankly, as a business strategy that, you know, if you're always just negotiating on price, somebody else is going to beat you. At some point, somebody's going to come in cheaper, even if they really can't deliver on it, just so they can get that business. So you really have to build relationships. And how do you do that? It's about shared values. And how do you express those shared values? By doing things together in your community and learning about each other in the process. And so to be able to have this conversation about this important need that frankly affects them as well as us, that's where a company like Arrow can facilitate that conversation.
Got another question?
Well, thank you for this wonderful engagement about business and education alignment. My name is Wei Liang. I'm from the state of Washington. And I really appreciate the comments you've made about the art of possible and also, you know, how to engage. My question is there a secret and key to unlock the business engagement? And if there is, how do we approach it? Because, you know, Noah, you said, you know, we need to be the lead. But in our position, you know, we need to engage those leaders like yourself. And how do we do that?
Actually, there is a secret, but it's not so special. Businesses won't do this out of the kindness of their heart. They're very pragmatic. If we don't make money at the end of the year, we go out of business. So the secret is proving that this model will make you more profitable, will make you more competitive both locally and globally. And there's now a ton of research in those countries that have done this that shows, in fact, that an apprenticeship model, that engaging students at an early age, results in more profitable bottom lines. So I think the secret is making that case, dealing with facts, dealing with research, and making the case to the business leadership that this is in your self-interest, and it's good for society and our community. But first, it's good for business, because it is.
And just to follow up, so 30% first-year attrition, you know, the recruiting, the training, the onboarding, the time to productivity, and then to lose someone within the first year is very, very expensive. We know that if we can reduce our first-year attrition by 1%, we can save $750,000 as a company. So if you do the math, if we can get people, and we know that when people leave, we do exit interviews, so we ask, why are they leaving? Well, sometimes it's, I don't have the capability, or it's a culture, or whatever it is. We know a lot of people are leaving because they don't have the skills to be productive and do the job right. And we're not giving them the training in the first year to get them up to productivity. So if you come to me and you say, hey, we can work with you to get your people through an apprentice model or other education models ready for the work that you need them to do, and we can help you reduce your attrition through that, that's the business case for us to partner. So you got to ask the right questions, I think. Where's the pain is one of them, and that's, and you know, we all have to control our costs. And so that's what our human capital is, our most precious resource, but also our most expensive.
In terms of not only approaching Arrow, but I think approaching any company, I think that what you said about, you know, we have to stay in business is absolutely true. I mean, that's the reality. And what, and how does that affect our decisions? Well, in my case, I only speak for myself. You know, I'm the guy, right? I'm the phone number that's listed. So I get calls and emails every day from all over the world for an extraordinary amount of money to address an extraordinary number of needs. And I'm not complaining about that, but it's the reality. So in order to get through my filter, well, I don't know any other way to say it, but it's all about me. I mean, when you approach a company, you have to approach them in terms of not what you need, but what the company needs. And if you do that, you're going to get a conversation, because nobody does that. There's perhaps necessarily so focused on what they need to get their important job done that it's always an ask and it's never really a two-way street. So being aware of that and being mindful of what we need to achieve at the end of the year, what goals we need to hit, will take that conversation much further and much faster. And so if there's a secret, it's putting yourself in my shoes too.
We've got time for one more question, and then we're going to have the panelists give some closing comments.
Thank you, gentlemen, for being present in this convening to support the work of school counselors. I have been a school counselor for over 30 years, and you asked, how do we sustain ourselves? We sustain ourselves because we're passionate about student-level outcomes. And to hear the business sector come here and say that our profession matters really means a great deal. So thank you for that. My name is Joyce Brown, and I am with a recently formed organization called the National Consortium for Postsecondary Counseling and Student Success. And this little group of ragtag people, a couple of people with an idea, have been the impetus behind all of these national convenings. And so I've heard all of you say, it works when you talk to kids. It works when you take them by the hand. And that's certainly what we do. So I'm all about innovation and ideas. So I'm putting it on the table. You gentlemen are the ones. You're our champions. That's what I'm looking for. So I'm saying the next step, can we have a conversation to continue these conversations? It won't cost you any money just to talk. But I'm telling you, you need school counselors. We are 100,000 strong in schools, rural, urban. I'm from Chicago, where we've done some amazing work with the least of these children. I know about some urban kids, but the pipeline is dwindling, and we need each other. We need to intersect. So I'm saying to you, can we continue this conversation to scale it up?
Yes.
All right, great.
Yes.
Gotcha. Yes. Wonderful. Thank you so much.
So for the panelists, are there some closing thoughts? If there was 60 seconds of wisdom that you'd want to make sure through our conversation everyone remembers, what would those be?
1-800 call Carl Marchetto. No, not to be flip, but I've just joined the Colorado neighborhood. I just joined with Lockheed a couple about a year and a half ago. So this is new for me at Lockheed. And I've had some great experiences at other corporations and would like to be involved. So I think this is not just about the young kids. It's about leadership throughout all of our careers. I think we've all had someone either guide us with a strong hand and say, stop doing it this way, I need this. Some have been more gentle, but I think we could all look back on our careers and there being these defining moments, whether we were learning on the job as a new leader, managing 40 people that were my dad's age at the time and breaking a lot of glass, and somebody taking me aside and say, you know, you're going about this wrong. But so I think that this is not a tour, it's a journey that we're on. And I think we just have to invest the time in our people. And it starts with identifying great kids that have support at home, maybe, or support through the counselors that are going to get them there. And then we can take them even farther from there. It's a two-way street.
It is a journey. But boy, is it a faster journey than it used to be, right? That's what 5 years out is all about, you know, that horizon. It's so much faster than it used to be. I think that, you know, going back to that innovation theme, innovation now is our competitive advantage in the world. The ability to pivot, the ability to change, the ability to invent and rapidly commercialize is our difference maker. And as Tony Wagner points out, we can teach innovation. It's not magic. It's not a myth. Hewlett and Packard, yeah, they worked in a garage, but they actually did something that can be replicated and a process that can be taught. And I think that's where we have to go. And the word applied has come up a couple of times. And I know that in my educational career, there was always this difference between, you know, people who did and people who thought. And, you know, boy, does that have to collapse really fast. Because, you know, as Tony points out, with the internet, and you know, we make the internet. So I mean, among other things. So it's, and we're part of this, is that knowledge is free now and it's ubiquitous, and you don't have to go to a place to get it. So what do we do with all that? We have to learn how to apply it and commercialize it in different ways. And I think that is the process that together, in order to get somewhere, that's what we need to work on together.
So I'll share with you a short story from the time I spent in Switzerland a year ago. So I was in this class, and by the third day, it was really clear to me that this is a powerful system. So I asked their Secretary of Education, who was running this thing, spending 11 days with us, said, Ursula, why is the country of Switzerland, and why are you spending this much time with people from all over the world around this system? And she said, a very kind of dry answer, she goes, well, this is a research institute. By working with other countries, we can learn better how to implement our system. And my inside voice, frankly, said bullshit. 11 days later, on the last night, when Ursula knew that we were serious about wanting to create change, I asked her the question again. And she said simply, she said, Noel, the truth is, I think the world's in trouble. And I think what we're doing in Switzerland can change things. And if we can share with the rest of the world what we're doing around ensuring that people have a hope for a good job and a good future, I think we can change the world. That I believed. And so the work that we're doing here in Colorado, the work that you're engaged in as counselors, is seminal, critical to the future of this country, I believe. Because as technology advances, as jobs are consumed by technology, skills and higher skills will be required to compete. That won't always be a college education. In fact, most likely, 70% of those jobs will be through an apprenticeship type opportunity, getting a certification, an accreditation. But this work is important. It's a movement. And so the challenge I'll have for you, you said there were 100,000. Well, we need an army of 1 million. Because you can't have 1 to 300 counselors in a classroom. We need to, as citizens, stand up and say, we need to change. As businesses, we need to change. And we need to come together to make sure that we have the most competitive world country in the world, that our people have the most opportunity. I believe this type of system can help do that. So I would say join our movement, let's learn from each other, and let's not stop till we win this war of making sure that we have good jobs for our people.
I'm walking away with a lot of thoughts, and it's just, it's great to be in a room with people that care and make a difference. And whether you call it a counselor or a mentor or a coach or a leader, these are all people that are doing something in service of another. You all are those people, and I hope you know, and I'm sure you know, that you make a difference, whether it's every day that you get thanked or not. Sometimes it is a thankless job. For me personally, other than my parents, there was one person in my life that was a counselor and mentor, and that person has shaped who I am. And so I continue to try to do that work, you know, as much as I can out in the community. And I do think that we need to find ways to get more people to understand the power of this work and get away from labels and get more to the work itself. And my challenge to all of you is to figure out ways to come closer and connect with us in the business world, because again, this isn't just about making a difference to people, which is very important. We cannot succeed unless we work together. It will not be possible. The art of the possible is when we create value in between, and the world is becoming more complex, more fragmented, and we need to figure out a way to come together. So the work really is to figure out those ways to connect. And I, being here in Colorado, and Western Union being all over the world, are interested in those partnerships. We just have to get in the room together.
Thank you all very much. Please join me in thanking Joe, Noel, Carl, and Josh for sharing their thoughts and their time. And I'm now going to turn it back over to Eric for his Master of Ceremonies.
So right now we are, again, let's have another round of applause. What an incredible conversation. And I think you heard a lot of the themes that we've talked about as a group together, where it isn't just about the academic pillar. You heard about the social emotional skills, the grit, the persistence, the tenacity, the work ethic. You heard about the value of internships. Someone earlier today came up to me and said, how did you get your job? And I started talking about the whole experience. But the joke that I have among people who say, I want to work at the White House, well, I say the best way to become a White House employee is to be a White House intern. Because truly, those are people who get an experience at the White House, and then they get that onboard experience. And that is really the best way to get a job there. And I think most importantly, you also heard personal and scaled experiences around how great education, great mentorship, great connections to careers can help people break the cycle of poverty, which is really one of our most ultimate goals for this work. So again, right now we've brought in a buffet. We're going to have lunch. We'll come together again at 12:40 while you're eating your lunch and announce next steps in terms of breakouts. But for now, we are on break. Use the restroom, grab some food, and we'll be serving lunch shortly. Thank you very much.